Our subject is Exceeding Great and Precious Promises, and our discourse theme text for today is 2 Peter 1:4, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Let's begin our examination of this text by reading the context, 2 Peter 1, verses 1 through 11. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. We know that word is agape love. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Verses 1 and 2 are an opening salutation. Beginning in verse 3, Peter gets to the point of this general epistle, and it's plainly stated in verses 10 and 11, an encouragement to all his brethren to make their calling and election sure. How? By making good use of the tools and resources Peter describes in the intervening verses 3 through 9. And the one tool and resource he mentions most times, 5 times, is knowledge in verses 2, 3, 5, 6, and 8. Now, interestingly, there are 2 different Greek words translated by the same English word knowledge in this passage. In verses 5 and 6, the Greek word is gnosis, Strong's number 1108, which has very much the same meaning as our common word knowledge and signifies having a grasp of certain facts, the what of a set of circumstances. In the other 3 verses, the Greek word is epignosis, Strong's 1922, which has a deeper meaning of discernment or recognition and signifies an understanding of the whole picture, the meaning and the import of the facts, the why and how of a set of circumstances, the total picture, not just the what. Looking at verses 5 and 6, Peter is describing gnosis, the facts of the doctrines of truth, as an element, a building block of growth into Christ-likeness, along with faith, virtue, and all the rest. In verses 2, 3, and 8, Peter is describing the end result, the epignosis of the growth into Christ-likeness, namely grace and peace, and an abundant entrance into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior. I'll give just one more illustration of the difference between these 2 Greek words with this question. Do you know about Jesus, or do you know Jesus? To know about Jesus is to have a grasp of the facts of his life and his teachings, like the word gnosis. To know Jesus is to have the mind of Christ, the Holy Spirit controlling our lives, like the meaning of the word epignosis. That's the difference between gnosis and epignosis. But both words are translated by the same English word knowledge in 2 Peter chapter 1. Let's move on now to consider a series of specific, exceeding great and precious promises and their importance to us in our walk along the narrow way. I'll begin with a few thoughts about that importance. First, the promises are spiritual food. We must feed on them and gain spiritual strength from them. Second, this spiritual feeding and resulting heart reliance must be done frequently, daily if possible. Some brethren make a habit of reading the daily heavenly manna daily. Another good practice would be to read an excerpt from the volumes or reprints daily or some passage in the scriptures that contain a precious promise. And I'll repeat this important suggestion when we consider another promise shortly. Third, claim the promises. Claim them as being made to you specifically and personally from our Father and from our Lord to you. You know, I think sometimes we allow ourselves to feel that the good things promised in the scriptures are not really for us, but are meant either for the church in a general way or for others more worthy than ourselves, or that humility should restrain us from being so bold as to think that the word of God and its promises are to us directly and individually. Stop such thinking. Don't let Satan block the promises from reaching your heart. They are yours. Fourth, have confidence in the promises. I'll read just one sentence from reprint page 4046. Those, therefore, who can and will exercise full faith, full confidence in all of the divine promises may go from victory to victory, from blessing to blessing, from joy to joy, from one attainment to another, and have a glorious victory in the end over the world, the flesh, and the adversary. There is so much more we could say about the importance of the promises, but I think the Apostle Peter said it all and in the best way possible in our discourse theme text. By these, ye might be partakers of the divine nature. So let's take a look at some of these specific promises. You know, I enjoyed the word association exercise that Brother George Balko gave us this morning when he mentioned a specific character quality or physical attribute and then asked us to associate a Bible character with that. Who did you think of first? Well, if I say to you, similarly, the word promise, what Bible character might come to your mind first? It would most likely be Abraham and the Abrahamic promise, in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed, which promise was then confirmed to Isaac and Jacob. And that's a wonderful promise indeed, but the first promise I'd like us to examine is not that one, although it is found in Genesis right after the Abrahamic promise is confirmed to Jacob. Let's read Genesis 28, 14 and 15. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south, and in thee and thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now that's the Abrahamic promise confirmed to Jacob, but here's the part I want to emphasize. The next verse, verse 15. And behold, I am with thee and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest. The context of this verse is familiar to us. Jacob is probably at the low point of his life. In fact, he's running for his life from his brother Esau, who has sworn to kill Jacob. Now, Jacob had been a shrewd negotiator in trading a mess of pottage for Esau's birthright, But now Jacob might be wondering if it was such a good bargain after all, if Esau is going to murder him before he has any children to receive and inherit that promise. The only possessions he has are the clothes on his back and the staff in his hand. He's hoping to first merely survive the journey to his uncle Laban, and then abide under Laban's protection. And right now everything is going wrong for Jacob. So God speaks to Jacob in the dream of the ladder reaching to heaven with the angels ascending and descending. And God says to Jacob, at the words we just read in verse 15, I will keep thee in all places whither thou goest. This promise given to Jacob is to us as well. God will keep us in all places wherever we go. And the thought of places is more than just geographical locations like New York or Chicago. It includes circumstances, relationships, health, finances, and every aspect of our lives. I fondly remember the wording on a plaque I saw in the home of Brother Adam and Helen Seawock in Canada. It said, God's providence will not lead you where his grace cannot sustain you. True and precious words indeed. Lay hold of this promise, not just in difficult times, but every day. Let's move on now to our second promise found in Psalms 25:12. What man is he that feareth the Lord? Him shall he teach in the way that he shall choose. The Hebrew word for fear here means reverence. And the key part of the promise is that we who reverence God will be taught of him. Both the doctrines of truth and the principles of righteousness. And our learning from this teaching takes work, diligent study, time spent sometimes to the point of weariness of the flesh. And it also includes the verbal sharing of like precious promises to those of like precious faith. I found this gem thought on reprint page 1320. Beloved, our advice to you in these perilous times when error is taking on its most baneful and deceitful forms, and when it is finding its most active agents among false brethren, and when sisters in your very midst, and when fidelity to the truth, therefore, occasions the severing of some of the tenderest social ties you have ever known, even among those with whom you once held sweet converse as you walked together to the house of God. Yes, in these times, let us again urge the counsel of Paul. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Let's move on now to our next precious promise number three, again in the book of Psalms, Psalm 91. For some of the brethren, this is their favorite psalm. I'll read the entire chapter, Psalm 91, verses 1 to 16. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom will I trust? Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh to thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him, and I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. There's a booklet that has been in circulation among Bible students for quite some time. Its title is Exceeding Great and Precious Promises. And the cover includes the words of our discourse theme text, 2 Peter 1:4. The style of the booklet is much like our daily Heavenly Manna book, in that this booklet, Exceeding Great and Precious Promises, quotes a scripture and then follows with a quotation or two from the reprints or the volumes. Usually the scripture quotes are only one or two from any given chapter in the Bible, but one of the exceptions is Psalm 91. The entire Psalm, except for three verses, is quoted in the book Exceeding Great and Precious Promises, along with comments. I'll select just a few verses and add a few thoughts on them. In verse 1, do you know where the secret place of the Most High is? Sure you do. It's the place of prayer. Do you know how to get there? Sure you do. You're there wherever you are when you pray. Do you know what you'll find there? Sure you do. Peace of mind, rest from your troubles, refreshment of spirit, and a warm, cozy feeling of safety and security from being in the shadow of the Almighty and under his wings, as verse 4 describes. In verses 5 and 6, the freedom from fear is a most precious promise. In the world today, men's hearts are failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming upon the earth. Luke 21:26. And this freedom from fear and peace in our demeanor is perhaps one of the most eloquent witnesses we can give to our friends, families, and neighbors. You know, there's an old saying intended to be humorous, which goes something like this. If you can keep your head when all around you are losing theirs, then you simply don't understand the situation. Well, brethren, we do understand this situation. We do see the silver lining of the kingdom behind the clouds of trouble tearing down the old order. And that's why we are unafraid. And we can keep our heads. And in these verses, 5 and 6, I can't help but think the arrows, a weapon of war, and also of the adversary, are a reference to all the nuclear missiles being fired and the armed conflicts around the world and the terrorist attacks that create so much fear in the world. And the pestilence by night is perhaps a reference to the invisible coronavirus that is likewise creating so much fear in the world. But as we see these things in the daily news accounts, we are not afraid. In verses 11 and 12 is one of the best promises in the entire Bible. Haven't we all, at least once or twice in our lives, and probably many more times, recognized when our guardian angels kept us from figuratively dashing our foot against a stone? The next verse, next to last verse of Psalm 91, is verse 15. And it reiterates the points we made earlier about claiming the promises in our hearts and in our prayers. And I like the thought that when we are in trouble, the Lord will first be with us in the trouble, giving us grace and strength. Then, when we have been rightly exercised by the experience, and only then, he will deliver us from the trouble. When we have learned the lesson intended and gained the victory designed for our growth in Christ-likeness. To complete our discussion of Psalm 91, I'd like to play a 4-minute video of parts of this psalm set to music. And I have to do a little bit of rearranging my desktop here. You should hear the music, but the screen will be dark for the first few seconds or even almost a minute of the prelude. So don't get excited if you can hear music, but you can't see anything on the screen.
Thank you.
Let's move on now to the New Testament and our fourth precious promise in John 15, 7. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Now this promise is unlike the others in that it is a conditional promise. It spells out two conditions that must be met before the promise will be fulfilled. This text is about prayer, which we've mentioned before in talking about previous promises we considered. The two conditions upon which our prayers will be heard and answered are namely here, abiding in Christ and having his words abide in us. So let's examine those two conditions. What does it mean to abide in Christ? And how can we have his words abide in us? Brother Russell has this gem thought on reprint page 4983. The conditions of the above statement or promise are two. The first is abiding in Christ. But what is it to abide in Christ? Only those can abide in Christ who are in Christ, who have come into him by faith, repentance, and consecration. And to abide in him means that, and here Brother Russell lists four things, that the faith will abide, the repentance for sin and the opposition to it will abide, and the consecration to the Lord and his service will abide, and it will be manifest that our will has been wholly consecrated, swallowed up in the will of Christ. Along the lines of abiding in Jesus, which means to abide or continue our consecrations in a vital living way, I recall something a brother once said in the context of the way brethren would often describe how long they had been consecrated or walking in the narrow way from sometime quite earlier, perhaps 30 or 40 or 50 years now. This brother that I recall would say, "Brother, the question isn't, was you consecrated? The question is you consecrated?" Not grammatically correct, but thought-provoking in any case. My own practical piece of advice on how to abide in Christ is this. Renew your consecration every day. Let me repeat that. Renew your consecration every day. Find some little concrete steps to take and then build on them with more and bigger steps every day. Here are a few examples. Every morning when you wake up, recite my morning resolve as soon as your eyes open. It will get your day off to a good start, like a good, healthy, spiritual breakfast. We all know most of my morning resolve by heart, so say it out loud or recite it mentally at the very start of your day. Here's another little concrete step. Do something small for one of the brethren every day. Send a personal email, spend 10 minutes on the phone, visit someone who is sick or shut in, of course, observing COVID restrictions. It should seem like a little thing to you, but it will be a big thing to your brother or sister. And there's a twofold benefit. Doing something for someone else not only helps them, but it helps you by taking your mind off of your troubles and worries. Renew your consecration every day, in small ways and in larger ways, as the opportunity provides, and thus abide in Christ. Now the second condition of this promise. What does it mean to have our Lord's words abide in us? Continuing the quote from the article I read a moment ago, reprint 4983, the other condition is also a weighty one. If my word abide in you. Ah, how evident it is that our Lord meant to associate himself and his word, the scriptures, in the minds, in the hearts, in the lives of all who are truly his. They must search the scriptures to know the will of the Lord, to know what he has promised, and what he has not promised, to know what they may ask and what they may not ask. And, ascertaining these, one fully consecrated, one controlled entirely by the will of God, will not want to be, to have, or to do anything except that which will be pleasing to the Lord in respect to himself. When this position has been reached, the will of Christ governing him, the words of Christ abiding in him, we can readily see that whatever would be asked by one thus well informed with respect to the divine promises and fully submissive to the divine will would be things which the Father would be pleased to grant in answer to his requests. End of quote. Search the scriptures. We call ourselves Bible students, and indeed we are. Therefore, let us be diligently in daily refreshing our contact with the Lord and our Heavenly Father through his word. In this regard, I like the illustration of Israel gathering manna in the wilderness. Remember how they had to gather it daily, except on the Sabbath, not just once a week or twice a week, but daily. And they couldn't just pick it up and put it in their mouths raw as they found it on the ground. They had to grind it and shape it into cakes and then bake it. So too, with our gathering of the truth, we have to gather it daily, not just once a week or twice a week when we come to meetings. And we can't just read the Bible and then close the book. We have to analyze it, ponder it, relate it to our understanding, and act on it. Apply it to whatever circumstances we are dealing with in our lives, just as the children of Israel had to grind and shape and bake their manna. There's an underlying principle here that I think is worth mentioning. Our minds are, in fact, two minds, two collections of knowledge and understanding and wisdom. One is the old mind, the other is the new mind. And as we feed and expand one, the other starves and shrinks. Do you want to kill your old mind? Then starve it to death by continually feeding on the new mind. And you do that by consciously and continually meditating on things that are true, honest, lovely, and of good report. Philippians 4:8. Returning to John 15:7, the last part of it says, "Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you." Now, this is a powerful statement. Ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. But there are qualifications to this seemingly broad statement. Here's one last quote from that excellent reprint article on page 4983. These requests would probably be simple, as was the master's petition when he prayed, "Not my will, but thine be done." In such a condition, prayers are always answered. But in such a condition, the prayers would be very modest. One's prayers under such circumstances would be more, and here Brother Russell lists three characteristics of a proper prayer: a thanksgiving for blessings, an expression of confidence and trust, and the committal of his way unto the Lord, confidently realizing the promise that to him, under such conditions, all things, even seeming disasters and troubles, shall work together for good. Hence, whatever came, such an one could realize his prayer answered. Continuing in the New Testament, our fifth precious promise is found in 1 Corinthians 10:13. "There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it." The Greek word translated temptation in this verse would be better translated by the English word trial. Trials are everyday things in the world which are common to mankind, as we know from 1 Corinthians 10:13. And I'm going to read this verse from the Diaglot. "No trial has assailed you except what belongs to man. And God is faithful, who will not permit you to be tried beyond your ability, but with the trial will also direct the issue that ye may be able to bear it." So here we are told that trials, The everyday things in the world are experiences that test and prove our character and loyalty to God and his principles of righteousness. Trials include such experiences as illness, financial setbacks, difficult relationships with family, neighbors around the job, leaky roofs, cars that won't start, losing your wallet, just missing an airplane, and a thousand other tribulations which are common to mankind. These trials prove our character, produce patience, make us perfect and complete, and gain us the crown of life. Well, our time is almost up. I'm going to skip through two more of the promises that I wanted to have time to deal with. There are so many that we could consider. And I'll end with this last precious promise found in Revelation 2:17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. There are several thoughts as to what the new name written on the white stone might be. One suggestion is that that name might be the name Christ, like as a bride takes the name of her bridegroom. And so that name on the white stone would be the same for every one of the 144,000, the name Christ. But there's another suggestion that I like a little better. And that suggestion is that the name on the white stone that each of us receives would be individual, tailored to us and reflective of some character quality that we each individually displayed as we grew in Christ-likeness. What do you think your name might be? Your new name written on that white stone that no man knoweth except you and your Lord. A name that reflects the character in you that the Lord saw was so precious and like his own. Will your name be perseverance, empathy, generosity, studiousness? There will ultimately be 144,000 different names written on the white stones, and I hope that one of them is yours. And may the Lord add his blessing.